There we go. I just wanted to give a 1 or 2 minute background on hepatitis C. So again, really the number one cause or indication for transplant in the United States is hep C, although there was an abstract from this meeting saying that fatty liver has surpassed it. If not, it will in the next 5 years. The most common cause of cancer, liver cancer, in the United States is hepatitis C. And again, 4 to 5% risk of death annually once you hit cirrhosis. Now, this is always a slide that surprises people for two reasons. Number one, many people aren't aware that the amount of death from hep C exceeds HIV. And number two, people don't realize that this was back in 2006 when this actually happened. So this is, again, surprising to people, but talks about the impact of hepatitis C. Now, we look at the REVEAL hep C study, and what we find there in the light purple is that the risk of death from all causes, not just liver, but other causes, is dramatically higher in people who are hep C positive with a positive hepatitis C RNA level. The other two are either negative or a negative RNA level with a positive antibody. Now, these are the old AASLD screening and testing guidelines, and we've seen and used these for years, and it basically took everybody who was at risk, IV drug abusers, people who had gotten blood transfusions and organs before 1990, 1991, positive mother for hepatitis C, etc. And these are still in place. So again, still feel free to use these. If you have a 25-year-old who comes in and uses heroin, they should be tested for hep C. The problem was in your average 40 and 50-year-old, it was hard to get many of them to admit to this. They didn't want it on their chart. And so what you've seen is kind of a change from, if you will, this risk-based cohort to an age-based cohort. So from my talk, if there's only a few things that you get out of it, one of it would be this, the change to the age-based cohort, the so-called baby boomers. Anybody born between 1945 and 1965 should get a one-time screening of hepatitis C. Turns out 70 to 82% of patients with hepatitis C are in this age cohort. Now, we'll talk about this guideline, and I'll come back to it, but basically AASLD got together with IDSA and really put together what I think is the definitive living and breathing guideline for hep C. And you really should be familiar with it. And what I love about it is that this guideline changes weekly, monthly, as new information comes out. So it's an online guideline that can be adjusted at any time. Now, we do talk about prioritizing patients for therapy and the idea that stage 4 cirrhosis should be given priority over 3, 2, 1, etc. is going to be important. So we need to stage these patients. In addition, obviously, if they have cirrhosis, we want to keep an eye out for varices, cancer, etc. So there are many ways to stage, and most people are not doing liver biopsies anymore. Again, nothing wrong with it other than the cost and the morbidity and even mortality, but the point is there are serologic markers, and then there's the transient elastography, almost exclusively ultrasound-based, such as FibroScan, but MRI is actually coming along and may take the place of this within the next few years. And so with the transient elastography, it's really about a 30-second ultrasound-based test, and you'll get a score back in kilopascals. And so in kilopascals, depending on what your score is, usually above 12 is cirrhosis, and then you see the others correlating there. And again, important to know where your patient's at. It will change the treatment a little bit, as I'll show you, and again, it works into prioritization. So the goals of therapy, unlike most viruses, this is a virus we can actually cure. So we talk about an SVR, or sustained virologic response, which used to be 24 weeks after treatment was completed, SVR 24. The government currently recognizes 12, or SVR 12. Most of us in hepatology, I think, are still doing 12s and 24s. Some are doing more, some are doing less. But again, at least a 12, if not a 24. Now, in terms of SVR, what we find is that if you achieve SVR, it's sustainable. More than 99% of patients will remain negative. But look at what we get out of it. Histology, better. Decompensation, decreased. Liver cancer, probably decreased. And I'm going to avoid that topic, but for our purposes, probably decreases liver cancer. And overall mortality. This was a study just about 2 years ago out of AASLD, and what you see here in red are patients with an SVR, in blue, patients without an SVR. And what you'll find here in the upper left corner is 5-year risk of all-cause death, whether average hep C, cirrhotics, or even hep C HIV co-infected. Dramatically lower with SVR. If you go across, you see liver cancer dramatically lower, and need for transplant was almost completely eliminated in this cohort if they achieved an SVR. Now, in terms of therapy, I'd like to say that liver doctors are geniuses and we've come up with this on our own. To be honest, what we've done is we've jumped on the HIV model. And the HIV model taught us that AZT alone wasn't the greatest choice, or DDI alone wasn't the greatest choice, but rather that we needed to actually hit different targets. And so you'll see when I show you the different treatments that are available to us, we're going to use a protease, we're going to use an NS5A, an NS5B, etc. And in the future, really not that far in the future, you're going to see more and more combinations coming forth. So in terms of decisions for treatment, you still need genotype for the moment, because 1A and 1B, depending on the treatment, might be treated differently. We talked about fibrosis stage, one for prioritization, but number two, because it might change how we treat them. I'll show you naive versus experienced. Again, slight differences. Drug-drug interactions, keep in mind protease inhibitors tend to interact with certain medications. It does not mean you can't use them, you just have to be aware of them and adjust accordingly. Depending on your state and your insurance, there may be a sobriety period of 3 to 6 months. And then Dr. Pordad's going to focus on the difficult patients, but to be honest, they're not nearly as difficult as this talk would have been 2 years ago, and I'll show a slide on renal failure and HIV positive. So in terms of a logical approach for these genotype 1 patients, what you need to know are a few factoids. Number one, your cure rates are going to be 95%+. And depending on the study, they'll be 95, 97, 99, or 100%. Discontinuation rates are extremely low. Do not forget this guideline website. If you do, just type in hepatitis C guidelines, this will pop up. And again, this is what we're going to come back to over and over. I'm going to show you some horrible charts. You do not need to memorize this. There is no reason to memorize this. But the point is, you'll come back to these guidelines and you'll say, okay, I have a Geno 1A who's not cirrhotic, who's naive. These are my 3, 5, 7 choices. So again, not to memorize, just know where to be able to look this up. And of course, insurance may choose for you or may choose not to treat for you as well. So in terms of the naives, this is for genotype 1. And I'll put in there that 3D is the AbbVie product. That's the paritaprevir, bitisvir, desabivir, ritonavir. It's easier to write down 3D for obvious reasons. Now, these are in no particular order. I'm not proposing that the top ones are better, worse, et cetera. I'm just showing you what's out there. And I updated this about 2 weeks ago, and don't be surprised if in 2 weeks there's different things in here. Now, the guidelines use expert opinion based on the data and based on the FDA. That does not mean that every one of these is FDA approved. However, we've had insurance companies making recommendations off these lists for non-FDA approved medications. So the point is, these are the guidelines. And as you see here, it'll depend a bit on whether you have cirrhosis or not. There will be 12-week regimens, there'll be 24-week regimens, there'll be with ribavirin, without ribavirin. Keep in mind, we keep trying to stab ribavirin in the heart and kill it off. It's not dead yet. And there still is a role for it, and we'll see in some of the more difficult to treat patients, it still exists. Now, the one that I will focus on for a second is the top regimen, which is sofosbuvir, ledipasvir, for 8 weeks in the non-cirrhotic with low viral load, hep cRNA less than 6 million. I'll give you a one-second little way to look at these drugs because people get very confused. Previrs are protease inhibitors, and all the companies have used convention here. So if you see the at the end, PREVIR, that's going to be a protease inhibitor. If you see Asvir, ASVIR, that's an NS5A. If you see Buvir, that's an NS5B. If you keep that in mind, that'll be the same for every one of these drugs. Okay, so which one do we choose? You've got too many choices here, and one of them must be good, one must be bad, and much must fall in the middle. Well, take a look here. This is just a summary using a lot of different combinations through a whole host of different studies, and you'll notice here not much different. Again, these are a bit of apples to oranges, so don't say that one is 95, it can't be as good as 98. The point is, all of these regimens in the registration trials got well above 90 and most of them approaching 100% for the naive genotype 1 patients. I mentioned that I was going to talk about the 8-week regimen. So again, if you have a treatment naive, non-cirrhotic patient, Geno 1 with viral load less than 6 million, you will notice there in green that 8 weeks of therapy was exactly the same as the yellow 12 weeks of therapy. So a nice cost savings, a helper in terms of patient compliance, so something we strongly recommend considering. Experienced. Now this is experienced to whatever, interferon, pegylated interferon, ribavirin. This is not necessarily experienced to five different DAA, direct acting antiviral combinations. So most of this is still peg ribavirin, maybe peg ribavirin, telaprevir, or boceprevir. And you'll see very similar, just different regimens. Some are unchanged from the naive, but some are different. Let's look at that same chart to try and figure out if one is so much better than the others. And the answer is that the rates are amazingly good and consistent above the 95% range. So again, treatment naive, we should be well above 95%. Treatment experienced will be in that same range. Safety. If they're effective and they're killing people off, not a great choice. Well, I highlighted here in red, and this is from the 3D regimen, discontinuation rates due to medication side effects, 0.6% out of 500 patients. I'd push you to try and find other medicines that have these kinds of rates. Show you sofosbuvir, ladipivir, and what you see here is in the two arms, in blue and in red, discontinuation rates somewhere between 0 and less than 1%. So very well tolerated. So registration trials are fake. They don't exist. You take patients, you take the perfect patients, you have the monitors, you call them 50 times a day. It's easy, relatively easy, to get those patients through. But let's talk about real world, because if this doesn't dictate into real world, aka telaprevir, then this becomes relatively useless. So let's see how this holds up. So I'll look at two very large real-world experiences, Hep C target, naive, experienced with and without cirrhosis, 97% SVR with soft ladipivir with treatment discontinuation under 2%. HCV trio, again, similar group, naive, non-cirrhotic, with and without ribavirin, 95-96% soft ladipivir with, again, less than 1%. So the point is this holds up in the real world, which what I want to do is encourage everyone in this audience, those who maybe aren't treating because you're a little nervous, this may be, you know, you may be thinking about HIV therapy and how difficult that seemed to be. This one really is, I don't want to call it a no-brainer, but we're getting there. Now, let's take a little bit worse group here. This was the VA real world experienced, and this was the toughest of the toughest. This was cirrhotics, including severely decompensated liver cancer post-transplant, and take a look there with two different regimens, the 3D and the soft ladipivir. Even in this tough to treat, not only are they tough to treat medically, they're also a VA population, which brings in other issues, still 94%. So I think the point is that that semi-fake world of registration trials actually does translate into the real world. Now, in terms of unique populations, without stealing Dr. Poor Dad's thunder, I just thought one of the comments or questions we get often is, yeah, but what about the co-infected? I'm terrified to treat them. And then renal failure you can't treat. There's no treatment for them. Well, take a look here. This is ION 4, ledipasvir sofosbuvir, treating HIV hep C co-infected. And you will notice that if I had laid down side by side the non-co-infected patients, the numbers would be essentially the same. So except for having to play a little bit with drug-drug interactions, treat hep C HIV co-infected the exact same as mono-infected. And again, I can show you the same data with elbisvir, grisopravir, and again, identical numbers to their mono-infected population. One of the hardest things that we had for a while was trying to treat patients with renal failure because sofosbuvir is not approved for GFR under 30. And so the most recently approved elbisvir, grisopravir, not too bad of data, 99 to 100% cure rates. So the point is these groups that are getting harder and harder to treat in the past few years are now getting easier and easier to treat and almost can be treated the same as just your standard run-of-the-mill mono-infected patient with normal renal function. And again, same principle here. Even in these patients with very advanced kidney disease, there were two arms to this study, but basically discontinuation averaged to about 2% in this population, or both populations. So really to summarize, what I'd like to say is we've started, and for those of you who saw Tram Tran's lecture on the present, past, and future, this is really exactly what we're seeing. We're seeing, when I first started, cure rates from interferon, the study said 16%. I don't think we ever saw 16%. But the point is that we've made progress. And as we see here, we really can get to a point we should be able to almost eradicate hepatitis C. So in my final conclusions, screen the baby boomers born between 1945 and 1965. Hepatitis C treatments should be approaching 100% cure rates with very low adverse events. Again, keep up at hepcguidelines.org. And again, these will continue to change and be updated. And I highly encourage you to take a look after the big meetings because they have their biggest updates then. And again, don't be afraid to treat because these are patients you're going to do a great service to. And this is not interferon. This is not the era of interferon. This is very easy and very beneficial. So with that, I'm going to actually hold questions. We'll do questions at the end.